What a life. What a life. I can't believe that this is my life. What a life. What a life. But I never trade for anybody else's life.
How do you think it's going so far?
I don't know. I just wish there was somebody that I could talk to for advice, to kind of, you know, check in with, to tell me, you know what I mean?
Why don't you just ask Dick Cavett?
Oh. Hello, Dick Cavett.
Oh.
Hi, Steve Buscemi.
You wish.
Yes.
Oh, you really are?
I am,
oh,
yes.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Well, the gypsy told me that I was going to meet someone named Steve, and I thought it might have been Steve Martin, but this is just as good.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that.
No, I'm really a huge fan of yours.
Oh.
As we can see, I am not huge in any aspect.
Did you hear that, Gio?
I heard it.
I'm
impressed. He'll probably help you.
Okay. All right. You probably have not heard, but I've been doing a talk show. Actually, it's a talking show.
Talking show.
It's a talking show.
Refreshing.
Yes, because we didn't want to be like all the other talk shows.
No, you don't want to be the British chat show.
No. Ours is a talking.
David Frost with eyes over his bags.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. You know, I'm struggling with this. Now, Jack Parr said to you when you were starting up your show.
Jack called. You're going to do a talk show, kid. Don't do interviews. And I thought, well, you know what, sing, read poetry. He said, don't do interviews. He actually said, that's David Frost and his clipboard, and what's your favorite color, and who do you think is the greatest this or that. Don't do that. He said, make it a conversation. And that's what Jack did.
Mm-hmm.
You've watched people talk on his show, and he got people to say things they never dreamed they would say. And I have done that, too, because I watched him every night of my life that I could before I ended up working for him. And my highest ambition was to be the guest in a talk situation.
Right.
I thought, if I can get to be on a talk show as a guest, I can go back to Nebraska and marry Cindy Lou. And
well, that's what I used to imagine as a kid, too. It's
did
not
you?
That, yeah, I mean, acting was like a fantasy, but really it was so that I could be on the Johnny Carson show.
No
I thought,
kidding.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, here, man. Isn't that what you do, or is it more like this?
I don't know.
We come from a tough neighborhood. See if you can believe this, Steve. A woman, rather witless woman, journalist from a Pittsburgh paper, came to New York and sat down with her little pad in front of my desk and said, what are the 10 rules of good conversation? I had not been let in on the fact that there were 10 rules.
Oh, so there are not 10 rules.
No, I didn't have any 10
Don't
rules.
Don't write this down.
I said, well, the first one is try to be within hearing distance of the person you're talking to. Try not to sing, laugh, or repair a diathermy machine while the other person is talking. She asked for the spelling of diathermy.
Wow.
I think I finally got to do not take hold of a wart on the other person's face and go honk, honk.
Did she crack a
that
smile
then? That was about
then?
Number seven.
She...
That cracked it. But she said, are you joking with me? As they say, they brought me two, and then they brought me two more. I nearly fainted when she asked that. At one point, I took her pad and wrote, he quipped. So, I don't know.
So, you know, I'm doing this talk show. And my question for you would be, if you were me, what kind of question would you ask you?
That is a stopper. I think I would first have to have studied both you and me extensively. Mm-hmm. That's one school of thought. The other one is, don't mess with a lot of preparation and study and analysis. Your best bet is to go with your gut and just go out there. I think George Bush did that with Iraq, didn't he?
Went with his gut.
Yeah, and we saw how well that worked. So I don't know for sure.
I wish there was a way that I could just observe you up close, you know, talking to someone, conversing with someone.
In committing the act of interviewing, speaking, conversing, yeah.
Well,
if I have my choice of people in the room, hope I'm right. Debbie?
Debbie Harry?
It's Cabot.
How? Hi.
And a man who claims to be Steve Buscemi.
Oh, him.
Yeah. Are you doing anything?
Well, I'm talking to his brother, Mike.
Yeah. I can see that.
Yeah.
Hey. Nice.
I didn't know you were at the corner.
Well, we're just right here.
There's a guy claiming to be your brother over there.
Yes, well, that is my brother.
Oh, that's, yeah, yeah, I met him earlier. Yeah. I didn't realize. Yeah. In fact,
You've been talking to him, too.
I thought it was you.
Hey, do you mind if you, if it's okay with you, Michael, that if you and Dick talk a little bit so that Michael and I can observe and maybe we can both learn something? How's that?
Okay.
All right. Mm. We need the park bench, though. Let's go steal another bench.
Okay. Steve, how should we start up here? What would you like from us?
I don't know. I just thought you would just know how to do it.
Oh, just show you how it's done, as they might crudely say.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So, here we are, and how are you, Debbie?
I'm very well.
Look wonderful. Of the two of us, you are the better looking.
Well, thank you. I mean, I take that as a very high compliment.
See, her face muscles relaxed, as you saw when I warmed up her a little bit.
So
like
you compliment.
That.
Yeah. A compliment doesn't hurt.
Yeah. So you were adopted.
I was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's called the slight startle question.
You just went right for it. You just went straight for it.
That doesn't always work.
No, because
sometimes it causes the person in Debbie's position to poke you in the eye and leave. Hey, why are there so damn few women stars of the sort you are?
I think there's an awful lot of them now. As a matter of fact, there are far too many, and I think they should all quit so that I can get ahead.
Yeah. My other question is, why are there so many female stars in the business? That's called the switcheroo, or send it right back. And it's kind of like a dipstick. You're trying to find out if the guest is putting you on or has a low level of put-on humor. Yeah. Would you agree that Frank Sinatra, who has never been mistaken for you or you for him, I'm certain, but the greatest pop singer of all time?
Well, he does have that great voice, but I've always sort of thought that maybe Sammy Davis had a better voice.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, Frank is so totally recognizable. Yeah. I mean, that's the key, to have that you have a recognizable voice.
I know, and it's a mixed blessing, too, because got my scarf up and I walk through the door and I say, excuse me, and they say, oh, I know who you are. Little Dickie Cabot from Gibbon, Nebraska. And I go and walk away. Mel Brooks taught me to do that. Have you met any of the crazy people? Well, I shouldn't say that, someone might be watching, but like Charlie Mingus, for example.
I wish that I had.
I had a show with Mingus.
Wow.
And people warned me. Because a few weeks earlier, up like you might be at a club with those circular ones.
Yeah.
Some guy said, you know, you are my sunshine, and Mingus kicked him in the face. we must try that more.
He must have a very high kick.
Yeah.
Or a short man, I don't know.
You are a wicked woman. I would love to grab you and kiss you right now.
Oh. Really?
Yeah, that's one of the most effective things you can say to a guest.
Really?
Yeah, and second only to grabbing and kissing them.
I think, did you get some good notes? Did you,
I did have one question. Okay. And you said the startling question. Wouldn't it be more startling if she didn't know, if you asked her a question, like say if she didn't know she was adopted?
I once said to Candace Bergen decades ago, I read that you were adopted, and she went, what?
That's perfect.
I thought, oh God, who told me this? Is it somebody who could have known and it's true? And she said, I don't think so. Anyway, that's the sort of thing to avoid.
Let's get Dick his coat.